Hello, friends, and welcome again to our study in the book of Daniel. I want to welcome those who are joining us across the country and around the world. We also want to welcome those who are here in person, our regular Sabbath School members, and those who are visiting with us today. Very warm welcome to you. And if you've tuned in, for those who are watching, or if you've been here in person before, you know this is an in-depth verse-by-verse study of the Old Testament book of Daniel. Today, we're going to be starting Daniel chapter 10. There are a total of 12 chapters in the book of Daniel, so we are nearing the end. But Daniel chapter 10, 11, and 12 are very important prophecies, very detailed prophecies. So we'll be getting to that, especially when we get to chapter 11. But before we start our study, as we always do, let's begin with prayer. Dear Father, we are grateful for your word. We are thankful for the opportunity to be able to gather together and open up the scriptures. Lord, especially these two passages that we find in the books of Daniel and Revelation that talk about prophecy are so relevant for us today. They go together, they show us where we are in the stream of time, and also bring to view some very significant events happening even now in heaven and a work of revival and reformation on the earth. And so, Lord, we do pray for your Spirit to guide us, lead us into a clearer understanding of your word, for we ask this in Jesus' name, amen. Last week, when we finished Daniel chapter 9, we made it all the way through the chapter, but we didn't finish the quiz. And those of you here in person, you have some notes. And so before we launch into chapter 10, we're going to finish up the quiz of chapter 9. Let's see how much you remember, right? So here is question number one. This is referencing chapter 9. What puzzled Daniel in regard to the time period of the vision of chapter 8? You remember in Daniel chapter 8? Daniel heard about a long time period, unto 2,300 days, then the sanctuary shall be cleansed. What puzzled him? Was it A, the relationship between the 2,300 days or years and the 70 years of Jeremiah's prophecy, the identity of the king of Babylon mentioned in the prophecy, or the interpretation of the morning star mentioned in the verse? Is it A, B, or C? What troubled Daniel? The answer is A. He was wondering about the relationship between the 70 weeks and the 2,300 days. The 70 years, I should say, rather. That was a prophecy of Jeremiah. Point number two. What did Daniel place his trust in when he fervently prayed for his people? Was it A, his own understanding and wisdom? Was it the power of the Babylonian Empire, or God's faithfulness to his promises? Where was his confidence? It was in the promises of God. So the answer there is C. Question number three. In his prayer, what did Daniel emphasize as the cause of any conflict failure? Now, when he's talking about conflict failure there, God had made a covenant with Israel. And if that covenant with Israel was to fail, whose fault was it? Well, A, God's unfaithfulness, B, human failings, or C, the inaccuracy of the prophecies. Is it A, B, or C? Why did God's covenant with Israel fail? Clearly, it's B, all right? God doesn't change. It's the same yesterday, today, and forever, but the human heart changes all the time. So the answer there is B, human failings. Point number four, in his intercession, what reason does Daniel give for his petition to be granted? So when he's interceding for his people, what evidence does he give? He emphasizes his personal righteousness and faithfulness. He pleads the honor of the Lord's name, citing the deliverance of Israel from Egypt. Or C, offers gifts and sacrifices to God as an act of humility. Where does he put his confidence that God is going to answer the prayer? Is it A, B, or C? The answer is B. He pleads the honor of the Lord's name. Now that's not unique. You find Moses interceding on behalf of Israel at a time of rebellion when the people rebelled against God at Mount Sinai. And again, God said to Moses, stand aside, Moses, let me destroy these people and I'll make a great nation of you. And Moses intercedes for Israel and he says, but Lord, what are the people going to say? You're the one who brought them up out of Egypt with a mighty hand. So he pleads the honor of God's name. All right, point number five. Who returned to help Daniel understand the vision that he saw in chapter 8? Was it the king of Babylon, a group of wise men from the Babylonian court, or the angel Gabriel? A, B, or C? The answer is Gabriel. Probably not a lot of wise men at the moment in the court of Babylon at that time. They had some problems. Point number six. What was the key element of the vision of chapter 8 that remained unexplained? What is it that Gabriel was not able to fully explain? Was it the rise of the new Babylonian king? or the 2300 days or years, or the destruction of the holy sanctuary? Was it A, B, or C? What part did he not understand? It was B. Had to do with the 2,300-day prophecy, Daniel 8:14, unto 2,300 days, then the sanctuary shall be cleansed. And so he was wondering about the meaning of that. Point number seven, what does the Hebrew word determine mean in the context of the vision? So the angel Gabriel appears to Daniel, and he says, I have now come forth to give you skill in understanding. And then he says, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people. And the word they determine means cut off. What does that mean? A, to foretell a future event, to cut off or measure off from a longer time period, or to predict an upcoming judgment. Is it A, B, or C? The answer there is B, means to cut off from a longer time period. So the angel Gabriel appears to Daniel, you'll recall in chapter 9, says, I have now come to give you skill in understanding. In other words, think about the 2300 days. Of the 2300 days, 70 weeks or 490 years are cut off for your people Israel. So of the longer time period, the first portion is specifically cut off. Why was it cut off? Well, that was the probationary time that God had given to Israel. Brings you up to 34 AD. So the answer is B. All right, number eight. When was the starting point then of the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem? The angel Gabriel says that at the decree for Jerusalem to be restored and rebuilt shall be 70 weeks or 490 literal years. When did that decree go into effect? There were actually three decrees that were given by various Persian kings. The first was by Cyrus in 536 BC. That allowed for the Jews to go back and start rebuilding Jerusalem, or rather the temple more specifically. The second was by Darius in 519, which was a repeat of the former decree because the rebuilding of the temple had run into some problems. And then the third decree, the one of Artaxerxes in 457 BC, that was the key decree that allowed the Jews not only to restore Jerusalem and the temple, but even to implement their own government within Jerusalem. So the one to restore and rebuild is 457 BC. That is the third decree. Do we have a question back there? Yes.
Good morning, Pastor.
Yeah, morning.
Back to number seven.
Yes.
Is there any scriptural support for the 490 years to be cut off from the 2300 as opposed to just cut off from the normal passage of time?
Okay. Can the cutting off just be referencing to time in general, or is it more specific to a specific thing that's being cut off? The wording there in the original Hebrew is designating that it is cut off from something. In order to cut off, it has to be cut off from something, not just generally. You wouldn't use that word if you're talking about time in general. But the context means that it must be cut off from something else, some larger time period. And the only larger time period in the book of Daniel is the 2300 days. So that's why scholars feel, well, he must be talking about the same thing. And of course, that was the part of the vision of chapter 8 that was not fully understood by the prophet, the 2300 days. When did that begin? And if what we read here in Daniel 9 does not apply to the 2300 days, we will never know when the 2300 days begin, because chapter 8 does not give you a starting point of the 2300 days. The only passage that gives a starting point is Daniel 9, where it says, the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. So it must have the same starting point, 457 BC. Good question. All right, point number nine. What event marked the anointing of Jesus by the Holy Spirit? You're recalling that 70 weeks or 490 years, it talks about an event taking place where it is the anointing 69 weeks into that time period of 483 literal years. The Messiah would be anointed. What was that? Was that Christ's crucifixion, his birth, or his baptism? Is it A, B, or C? C, Jesus anointed by the Holy Spirit at his baptism, and the Holy Spirit came upon him, and God the Father said, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. Question number 10, what event marked the end of the Old Testament sanctuary services? Was it the birth of Jesus, the tearing of the veil at the moment of Christ's death, or the publication of the book of Daniel, A, B, or C? Clearly the answer is B. Who tore the veil in the temple when Jesus died on the cross? Was it the priest? No, it was God himself. How do we know that it was God or an angel that was sent to tear? How do we know? Because it tore from the top all the way to the bottom. It wasn't somebody at the bottom tearing to the top. So it was God bringing an end to the sacrificial system, the earthly sanctuary service. All right, question number 11. Who are the people of the prince who is to come in the passage? Well, incidentally, the people of the prince who is to come, they are the ones who are to surround Jerusalem and destroy both the city and the temple. Who are they? Well, was it the Jewish resistance fighters? Was it the Egyptian ambassadors? Or was it the Roman soldiers under the leadership of Titus in 70 AD? Is it A, B, or C? Clearly, the people of the prince who is to come refers to the Roman armies under the prince being Titus. Number 12, how long did Jesus confirm the covenant with Israel during his public ministry and by his apostles? So Christ began his public ministry in 27 AD. He preached for 3.5 years. 3.5 years after his baptism, Christ was crucified. He ascended to heaven. But for another 3.5 years, the preaching of the apostles was almost exclusively to the Jews until in 34 AD, a very significant event happened. What happened in 34 AD? Stephen was stoned, and there was a young man whose name was Saul. And that same year, on the way to Damascus, he is converted and he becomes Paul, and Paul is the apostle to the Gentiles. So that probationary time period ended at the stoning of Stephen in 34 AD. How long did Jesus confirm the covenant with Israel? Was it 7 days or 7 years? It's 7 years, 3.5 in person, and then 3.5 through his apostles, brings you a total of 7 years. So the answer there is 7. Yes, question.
Yes, I have another question for you. Back to number 11, if the people of the prince who is to come are Romans, who is the prince who is to come?
Okay, the people of the prince who is to come, the prince there is Titus. The word prince means a ruler, a commander, not necessarily the son of the king. So a prince could be referred to as a general, a commander, one in charge. And many Bible scholars have recognized that as being Titus. He was the one who actually led the Roman armies. And at first, Titus didn't want the temple to be destroyed. You'll recall the story. He told them, save the temple. But one of his soldiers threw a burning torch into the temple, and of course, it caught on light, and then the gold began to melt, and then everyone rushed into the temple, and the city was destroyed. So the prince there, small letter P, it's not Messiah the prince. Messiah the prince is Jesus, because it's Messiah the prince. This prince is not the Messiah. Thus, the people of the prince, it's referring to Titus and the Romans. Yes?
But in Matthew 24, Jesus specifically says that when you see the abomination of desolation of Daniel 9, in the temple, get out of town or get out of Judea, because it's going to get worse than it has ever been in the past or ever will be thereafter, which is clearly a reference to the tribulation, which is still in the future. So this prince of the people must be still in the future.
Okay, well, let me answer that. Yes, that's a common question. You know, that is one of the ideas, especially connected to a futuristic interpretation of Bible prophecy. We don't hold to futurism. We hold to historicism. That was the view of the Protestants when they studied these truths. They understood the historical application of these truths. They didn't take the last week of the 70-week prophecy and put it into the future and say that an Antichrist power would arise after the temple has been rebuilt in Jerusalem, and he would form a covenant with the Jews for a week, but in the middle of, or 7 years, in the middle of that 7 year period, he'll put an end to the sacrifices in Jerusalem. That's not what this is referring to. Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he says, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place, then let them in Judea flee to the mountains. So who's he talking to? He's talking to his disciples. And he says, when you see the Romans surrounding the city, know that its desolation is near, fleeing to the mountains. Well, was there historic fulfillment of that? Absolutely. Did the Christians in Jerusalem remember the warning given by Jesus that when they saw the Romans surrounding Jerusalem, that it was time for them to flee from Judea? Yes, they did. Many of them fled to Petra, which is a city, very interesting city, just in the Jordan area on the other side of the Jordan River. It's a city carved out of rock. Some of you might have even visited that, served as a place of safety for a number of Christians fleeing from what was to come to Jerusalem. So that warning, that prediction made by Christ met a very literal fulfillment. The temple was destroyed, the city, Jerusalem was taken over by the Romans. Jerusalem is now back in the hands of the Jews, but the temple has not been rebuilt. Will the temple be rebuilt before Jesus comes? The Bible doesn't say. It might not. But is there any significance to sacrifices starting up in a temple rebuilt in Jerusalem today? Does that have any meaning for the Christian? What happened when Jesus died on the cross? The veil was rent. God himself said, forget this temple. This earthly temple has no meaning any longer. Where is our focus? Not an earthly temple, but a heavenly temple, according to the book of Hebrews, where Jesus, our high priest, is ministering for us in the heavenly sanctuary. Now, could there be a broader application to the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, Jesus mentioned in Matthew 24? Yes, it could be, because we need to recognize that pagan Rome was followed by papal Rome, and we understand that papal Rome will do certain things as we near the end of time that has to do with worship, has to do with a violation of one of God's commandments that'll be forced upon the world. There is a dual application. We might even touch on that a little bit when we get to Daniel 11, more of the details. But here it's referring to the historical event, the destruction of Jerusalem. Yes, I'm going to keep moving because we've got to get to chapter 10. Go ahead.
Following up on this thought that you were just expressing, why would the futurist people be interested in animal sacrifices when we all know that animal sacrifices don't do anything?
Yes, absolutely. There is no value to animal sacrifice. Even the Jews themselves, even the most orthodox of the Jews, now they might be a small group, but the vast majority are not in favor of animal sacrifices anymore. They've sort of spiritualized the whole sacrificial system. Let me give you a quick background as to why this idea even persists today in Christian churches. There are three views for interpreting Bible prophecy. There is the historist position, which is the position that was held by Martin Luther, John Calvin, Knox, Jerome, Huss, and many, many others, right? This is the historical interpretation of Scripture. But at the time of the Reformation, when Luther and others were identifying the Roman Church as being the Antichrist power and the little horn power of Daniel, the Roman Church had to do something. And so there were two scholars, both of which came up with two views of interpreting Bible prophecy. The one view was known as preterism. And basically, preterism says all of Revelation met its fulfillment in the first 100 years after Christ. So if you're looking for the beast power, don't look to the Roman Church, it's Nero. So all of that met its fulfillment around 100 AD. That's the preterist view. It got on a little bit, but it never gained that much momentum. But Ignatius Loyola, he was probably the most famous of the futurists. He, of course, began the Society of Jesus or the Jesuits, and he brought forth the view that prophecy, everything from Revelation chapter 4 onwards, is for a future time period. And he connected that future time period with this last week of the 70 weeks of Daniel. And he cut off that last week and he applied it to some distant point in time and said an Antichrist power would arise and he would rule from Jerusalem after the temple has been rebuilt. And that caught on, even though Protestantism was built upon historicism, that caught on amongst many evangelical churches today. And of course, there is an effort to try and unite Protestantism with Catholicism. So that became convenient. And so the historical interpretation kind of began to be set to the side, and the futuristic view began to be promoted. There are big problems with a futuristic view. For one, you have 70 weeks, and then you have 1 week cut off and thrown way into the future. Where in the Bible do you have a time period where part of that time period is not part of that time period, but is cut off and applied to some other time period that has no beginning or no end? So the Bible has to be consistent. Prophecy has to be consistent. We need to allow the Bible to interpret itself. Okay, moving on here. Almost done with that quiz, all right? We're getting there. We're getting to chapter 10. Question number 13. What event marked the end of the probationary time that God had given to the nation of Israel? Was it the stoning of Stephen in 34 AD, the destruction of Jerusalem by the Romans in 70 AD, or the legalization of Christianity in 313 AD? Is it A, B, or C? The answer is A, all right? The stoning of Stephen marked the end of the 70 weeks, 34 AD. Final question. According to the prophecy, when did the investigative judgment begin? Now remember, the first 70 weeks, 490 years, is cut off from the longer time period known as the 2,300 years. When did that time period in the 2300 days? Was it in 34 AD at the stoning of Stephen, 70 AD, the destruction of Jerusalem, or in 1844 at the end of the 2300-day year prophecy? A, B, or C? The answer is C. We are now living during that time period of cleansing, the cleansing of the heavenly sanctuary, the cleansing of the church. Now, having said that, just a quick reminder, here's this very important time prophecy. It's important for us to understand it. I know you might not be a big history scholar. This is not that complicated, but it forms the foundation to understanding both Daniel and Revelation. You have your first 70 weeks or 490 years beginning in 457 BC. That ends in 34 AD. That's when probation closed for the Jewish people. That was the stoning of Stephen. 7 years before that, in 27 AD, you have the baptism of Jesus. 3.5 years later, in 31, you have Christ crucified. Then you add from 34 AD, 1,810 years, because that's what's left of the 2,300. If you take 490, you take 2,300 minus 490, you end up with 1,810. So we add that time period on. From 34, it goes into the future, and it comes to 1844. So in 1844, according to the verse, for unto 2,300 days, then the sanctuary shall be cleansed. There was no earthly sanctuary at the time. There was no temple in Jerusalem. There was an earthly sanctuary, but that was the church. That's the individual, the heart. There is a heavenly sanctuary that the Bible makes very clear in the book of Hebrews. And the work of cleansing in the heavenly sanctuary is a reflection of a work of cleansing that Jesus is doing in his church. And in 1844, we began to realize some very important truths that had been forgotten during the Dark Ages, that had been set aside. Truths referencing, for example, your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. You need to honor God. Whether you eat or drink, whatever you do, do it to the glory of God. That we have a health message. We need to honor God by taking care of our body. The wonderful truth about the Sabbath. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days, labor into all your work, but the seventh is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. People had forgotten about the Sabbath. The truth about the second coming, that when Jesus comes, he comes that every eye will see him. The dead in Christ will be raised first, and the alive will be caught up to meet him in the air. People had forgotten about that. The truth about when you die, you don't immediately go to heaven or hell, but you're sleeping in the grave. You're at rest until the resurrection. Then the righteous are resurrected and taken to heaven. Nobody is burning in hell now. They began to discover that hell takes place at the end of the 1,000 years when the devil and his angels are cast into the lake of fire, and the fire that purifies the earth destroys the wicked, and then Jesus makes a new heavens and a new earth. These were some of the truths that were being brought to light around 1844. There was a cleansing of the church that was taking place at the time as there was a cleansing of the heavenly sanctuary. Does that make sense? Very significant event. That's why we have it mentioned in prophecy, 1844. Whew. All right, are you ready for chapter 10? That was just a warm-up. Okay, here we go. Daniel chapter 10, beginning in verse 1. It says, in the third year of the reign of Cyrus, king of Persia, a message was revealed to Daniel, whose name was called Belteshazzar, not to be mixed up with Belshazzar. Who was Belshazzar? He was the grandson of Nebuchadnezzar, and he was the king in Babylon at the fall of Babylon when it fell to the Medo-Persian. Anyway, Belteshazzar is Babylon. That's the Babylonian name of Daniel, I should say. Belteshazzar, Babylonian name of Daniel. It says, the message was true, middle of the verse, but the appointed time was long, and he understood the message and had understanding of the vision. So apparently, Daniel had been doing some Bible study. And based upon his study of the prophet Jeremiah and reading some of what Isaiah had to say, as well as the revelations that had been given to him, he understood something about a time prophecy. And we're going to see what prophecy that is here in just a minute. All right, take a look at the note. The detailed prophecies found in chapter 10, 11, and 12 cover the whole period of the 2,300 years and reach to the very time of the end. The vision finally concludes with the second coming of Jesus, when many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life and some to shame and everlasting contempt. So chapter 10, 11, and 12 is really one big vision. It's a very detailed vision. We're going to get into some very detailed histories when we get to chapter 11. But think of it as one. So chapter 10, chapter 11, chapter 12, they all go together. Okay, next part there, it says, in 536 BC, Cyrus the king issued a decree that allowed the Jews to return to Jerusalem and start the reconstruction of the temple. This event marked the end of the 70 years of Babylonian captivity, as stated by Jeremiah the prophet. So Daniel had been reading Jeremiah. Now, who was Jeremiah? Well, Jeremiah was a prophet who was in Jerusalem at the time when Jerusalem fell to the Babylonians. He was actually one of the prophets in Jerusalem that were telling the king and the rulers of Jerusalem to submit to the Babylonian king. But they kept trusting in the Egyptians, thinking that the Egyptians would come to their deliverance. And Jeremiah says, no, submit to Nebuchadnezzar. He's the one that God has chosen to be in power. Submit to the king. And of course, they didn't. Eventually, Jerusalem was destroyed. But this is what Jeremiah the prophet had written, and this is what Daniel read. You find in Jeremiah chapter 25, chapter 25 and verse 11. Jeremiah predicted, he said, the whole land shall be a desolation and an astonishment. He's talking about Jerusalem. And these nations shall serve the king of Babylon for 70 years. How long were the nations to serve the king of Babylon? 70 years. Now, Daniel read that while a captive in Babylon. Then the verse goes on, verse 12, then it will come to pass when the 70 years are completed that I will punish the king of Babylon and the nations and the land of the Chaldeans for their iniquities, saith the Lord, and I will make it a perpetual desolation. So Daniel realizes that for 70 years, the Jews were to be in captives or captives in Babylon, but at the end of that time period, judgment would come upon the city of Babylon and the Jews would be allowed to go back to Jerusalem. Well, verse 2, in those days, I, Daniel, was mourning 3 full weeks. So he's reading Jeremiah, he's understanding these prophecies, but he begins to, in a special way, pray and intercede. Something had happened in the rebuilding of the temple. Daniel could not join the returning Jews on their journey back to Jerusalem, but with deep interest, he followed their progress in the rebuilding of the temple. However, a great hindrance to the work had arisen, and Daniel knew about this. The Samaritans, jealous of the favor shown to the Jews, were actively trying to stop the rebuilding of the temple by sending false reports to Cyrus, the Persian king. And here you have it recorded in Ezra, Ezra chapter 4, verse 4 and 5. It says, then the people of the land tried to discourage the people of Judah, and they troubled them in building. And they hired counselors against them to frustrate their purposes all the days of Cyrus, king of Persia, even until the reign of Darius, king of Persia. So the Samaritans didn't want the Jews to build the temple. Let me give you a little bit of the background. You'll recall that you have the first king of Israel. His name is Saul. Saul dies, and then, of course, David becomes king. David's son, then Solomon, rules. Solomon has a son by the name of Rehoboam. Well, after Rehoboam is made king in Israel, the 10 tribes of the north, they come to Rehoboam and they said, your father Solomon laid a heavy tax burden on us. But, we want you to kind of lighten that load. And so Rehoboam consulted with the older wise men that were before his father, and they said, well, be good to the people and they'll be good to you. Then he consulted with the younger wise men that kind of grew up with him, and he said, well, what should I tell the people? And they said, well, you need to tell the people. You need to show the people who's boss. You need to be firm. So Rehoboam, foolish king, takes the advice of the younger counselors, and he tells the people, he says, my father's thigh shall be like my little finger. He beat you with whips. I'm going to beat you with the tails of scorpions. Well, that didn't go down very well with the 10 tribes of Israel, and they separated. The kingdom was divided. They made Jeroboam their king. So Jeroboam was king of the north, and Rehoboam was king of the south. There was a bit of a civil war, but finally things settled down, and you had two kingdoms. The kingdom in the north, the capital of which was in Samaria, the kingdom in the south, the capital of which was Jerusalem, the kingdom of the north kept going into idolatry over and over again, even faster than the kingdom of the south, until finally the Assyrians came and conquered the 10 tribes of the north. Most of them were taken off and dispersed throughout the Assyrian kingdom. But there were some who were left to kind of take care of the vineyards and that type of thing, take care of the fields. They ended up intermarrying with some of the Assyrians. And these Jews that married the Assyrians came up with a hybrid type religion. They claimed to be worshiping the same God that the Jews worshiped. But they had added into their form of worship all kinds of idolatry and pagan practices. And of course, when Jerusalem fell to the Babylonians in 605 BC, now you have at the end of 70 years, the Jews from Judah coming back to rebuild the temple. The Samaritans, who are the ones who were Jews, but they intermarried with the Assyrians and they formed this hybrid religion, they said to the Jews that had come back from Babylon, we're going to help you build the temple. And the Jews said, no, you can't help us build the temple because you don't worship God the way we worship God. You've kind of got this strange hybrid. Well, that upset the Samaritans. And so they wrote letters back to the Persian kings telling them that these Jews are troublemakers. You don't want them here building the temple. And that animosity between the Jews and the Samaritans continued all the time till Jesus. You remember the story where Jesus was talking to the woman at the well? And she, after Jesus said, if you would have asked of me, I would have given you living water. And she said, Lord, give me this water that I need not come. And then Jesus said, well, go call your husband. And she said, well, I'm not married. And Jesus said, you've answered right. You've had so many husbands, 6, 7 husbands. The one that you're with now is not your husband. And she said, oh, I perceive you're a prophet. Then she said to Jesus, our forefathers worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews say the place to worship is in Jerusalem. So after the Jews, after the Babylonian captivity, when the Jews came back and rebuilt the temple, and the Samaritans asked if they could help build the temple, and the Jews said, no, you can't help us build because you don't worship, they got very upset with the Jews, and they went and they built their own temple on Mount Gerizim. And the Samaritans claimed that was the true place to worship God. Now, at the time of Jesus, the temple on Mount Gerizim, for the most part, had been destroyed. It was just ruins. But still, the Samaritans claimed that to be the place to worship. So that's why there is tension between, well, at least in Bible times, between the Samaritans and the Jews. And we see that tension throughout history, and it's even played out today between the Jews and the Palestinians, those who have lived in that area, that vicinity. So that's the conflict, if you trace it all the way back. That's why the Samaritans tried to stop the building of the temple. Well, Daniel, who's in Babylon, he hears reports that the building of the temple is being stopped because of the opposition of the Samaritans. So what does Daniel do? He begins to fast and pray. A good thing to do when you're facing trials and difficulties, right? Fast and pray. All right, let me read the next note here. Daniel detected a change in the king's attitude towards his people and the diminishing of support for their work in rebuilding the temple. With a heart burdened for the restoration of the temple and its sacred services, Daniel engaged in fasting, mourning, and earnest intercession with God. All right, point number 3, moving right along. He says, I ate no pleasant food. No meat or wine came into my mouth, nor did I anoint myself at all till 3 whole weeks were fulfilled. Let me say something about no meat or wine came into my mouth. That does not mean that Daniel drank alcohol prior to him doing this fast. All you have to do is go back to Daniel chapter 1, I should say, and you'll recall that Daniel and his friends made a firm decision that they were not going to defile themselves with the king's wine or with the meat that he ate. Now, why would Daniel not drink the king's wine? Because it was fermented wine. It was alcoholic. The word wine can mean grape juice, just the juice from the grape. It could be new wine, sometimes referred to in Scripture, but it's really the context that tells you if it's fermented wine or if it's pure grape juice. Daniel never drank fermented wine. And when it says meat, it's not talking about T-bone steaks here. It's not talking about pork chops, because Daniel was very clear as a Jew. He didn't eat any unclean foods, nor did he eat meat with its blood, right? Actually, if you're reading Daniel chapter 1, they asked for a vegetarian diet, and it proved to be very good for them. So if it was meat, it was the clean meats, and for sure we know there was no alcoholic wine involved in this special time of fasting. He laid that aside, and he sought the Lord. He must have eaten something very simple during this time of searching for the Lord. I'll get to your question in just a minute. There remains aspects of the previous prophecy that Daniel had not yet fully understood, especially as it relates to the obstacles that the Jews now faced in rebuilding the temple. Through his earnest supplication, he received more information concerning the Jews, as well as the outline of the most significant events that would affect the people of God from his time all the way to the second coming of Christ, because you have chapter 10, chapter 11, chapter 12, they're all together. Daniel's affliction of soul reflects the attitude that will characterize God's people in the last days. As Daniel prayed for the restoration of the temple at the end of the 70 years, so the people of God in the time of the end will pray For the cleansing of the church, as reflected in the cleansing of the heavenly sanctuary. Is there a need today for revival and reformation in the church? Absolutely. Daniel earnestly sought the Lord that there could be a restoration of true worship. God's people today ought to be praying and saying, Lord, please bring revival to your church. Help us to be faithful to your word. May we not get distracted by the things of this world or by false teachings or doctrines. Let us be true to the word of God. So there's a parallel in Dan's experience with the experience of God's people at the end of time. Yes, we got a question.
Yes, concerning the separation of the 10 tribes of the north, was Jeroboam also a member, a member of the line of David? And do we know, was there a Levite contingent that went north to serve in the temple in the north?
Okay, good question. All right, so Jeroboam, was he a descendant of the tribe of Judah? I don't know. That's a good question. Probably not, but I could be wrong. Maybe someone could correct me. Secondly, were there some of the Levites that stayed up in the area of Samaria? Most of the Levites stayed around Jerusalem, although the Levi cities were scattered, some of which were over there. The kings, Jeroboam and others, were able to create their own priesthood, and they created their own sacrifices in Samaria. But you read the story of a prophet, we don't know his name, who came up from Jerusalem during the time of Jeroboam, after he built the temple, and he cursed, or not the temple, the altar, and he cursed the altar, and he was the one that got eaten by a lion because he wasn't supposed to stay and eat with the old prophet. You remember, it's a very interesting Old Testament story. But they did try and create a form of worship because Jeroboam realized if his citizens are all going down to Jerusalem to worship, he's going to lose his influence over them. So they try to create their own type of worship, but it never matched that of Jerusalem. Most of the Levites stayed in the south. So you have Judah, one of the largest tribes, Benjamin, one of the smallest tribes, and the Levites pretty much made up the tribes that stayed in the south. The reason you have 10 tribes in the north and 2 tribes of the south, Levi is not specifically mentioned. It was actually the 13th tribe because they didn't receive an inheritance, but they were scattered throughout the people. But the majority of the Levites stay down in Judah, close to Jerusalem. Okay, moving on. Here's a verse, Malachi chapter 3. So we're talking about a work of revival and reformation that is to happen. Malachi chapter 3, verse 1, it says, Behold, I will send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. So let's pause right there and talk about this verse. This is a prophecy, and it talks about the messenger of the covenant that'll prepare the way before the Lord, and then the Lord will appear in his temple. Did that meet a historical fulfillment? Was there a messenger that went before Jesus to prepare the way for Jesus? Who was that messenger? John the Baptist. And did Jesus appear in the temple? Yes. Christ's first appearing in the temple after his baptism involved the cleansing of the temple. Jesus cleansed the temple at the beginning of his earthly ministry. He cleansed the temple at the end of his earthly ministry. But there is a broader application to this verse because not only is there an earthly sanctuary, there is a heavenly sanctuary. Because read on. Verse 2. But who can endure the day of his coming? And who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like a launderer's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. He will purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver that they may offer to the Lord an offering in righteousness. So not only did this refer to what happened when Jesus cleansed the temple at the beginning of his earthly sanctuary, but according to Daniel 8:14, unto 2,300 days, then the sanctuary shall be cleansed. There will be a second cleansing of God's people at the end of time before Jesus comes. Because look at the next verse, Malachi chapter 3, verse 16, same book. It says, then those who fear the Lord spoke to one another, and the Lord listened and heard them. So a book of remembrance was written before him for those who fear the Lord and for those who meditate upon his name. Pause right there. There's a lot in this verse. There is a book of remembrance written before the Lord. Where's the Lord? In heaven. So where must this book of remembrance be if it's before the Lord? It would be in heaven as well. A book of remembrance is written before the Lord, talking about the heavenly sanctuary, talking about those books of record. Remember Daniel chapter 7 says the judgment was set and the books were open? Daniel chapter 7. Then verse 17, God says, they shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts. In that day that I make them my jewels, I will spare them as a man spares his own son who serves him. What event is being described there when it says, on the day that I make them my jewels? What event? When do we receive our reward? When do we receive our crowns of gold and white robes? It's the second coming of Christ. So this is referring to a work of cleansing that occurs before Jesus comes in his church, amongst those who profess faith in him. All right, verse 4. Now on the 24th day of the first month, I was by the side of the great river, that is the Tigris River. This date in the book of Daniel is the only one specifically mentioning an exact day and month that you find in the book. It is unclear whether this reckoning follows the Persian or the Jewish calendar. They had two different calendars. If Daniel's date aligns with the Persian calendar, Cyrus's third year's first month would be around March or April 536 BC. Alternately, if Daniel would have used the Jewish method, it would have been 12 months later, also around March or April 535 BC. It's interesting, however, to note, either calendar, Daniel's fast extended through the Passover season. Of course, the Passover was very significant in Jerusalem. It was one of the greatest of the feasts. That was the great feast where the people of Israel were to gather around Jerusalem. The building of the temple had begun, but it appears that this Passover was not able to be completed because the temple's rebuilding had been hindered by these false reports that had been sent back by the Samaritans. And so around this time, when there should be great rejoicing in Jerusalem, during the time of the Passover, Daniel is fasting because the work of the temple is not moving forward. Okay, verse 10. Sorry, chapter 10, verse 5. He says, I lifted up my eyes and looked, and behold, a certain man clothed in linen, whose waist was girded with gold of Ophez. All right, big clue here. Here is an individual wearing the high priest's robe or high priest's garment. That's linen. And he has a golden chain girt around his waist or around his chest. This is identifying this special being as high priest. It's not an angel. We're going to find out it's Jesus in just a moment. It's actually Michael. We know Michael is the prophetic name of Christ, and we're going to get to that. So in this passage, the prophet Daniel witnesses a vision of Christ before his incarnation. Jesus, accompanied by an angel, another angel, imparts knowledge to Daniel about events that are soon to take place in the future. The significance of Daniel's final prophecy is seen in its parallel to the book of Revelation, as both begin with the revelation of Jesus. So here, after Daniel is praying and fasting, he sees a being dressed in white linen with this band of gold. Now take a look at what John sees in Revelation chapter 1. Revelation 1, verse 12. Then I turned to see the voice which spake with me, John says, and having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. Pause right there. In the earthly sanctuary, which is a pattern of the heavenly, where would you find seven golden lampstands? Would it be in the courtyard, in the holy, or in the most holy place? It would be in the holy place, right? Remember, as we've mentioned before, the courtyard of the sanctuary represents the earth. Why do we say the courtyard represents the earth? What happened in the courtyard? That's where the lamb was sacrificed. Where was Jesus sacrificed for our sins? On the earth. So the courtyard represents the earth. But Jesus rose from the dead and he ascended to heaven and he began to work as our high priest first in the holy place. That's the first compartment. And then in 1844, at the end of the 2300 days, we see Jesus going from the holy place into the most holy place for this final work of judgment. But here, Revelation was written somewhere around 90 AD. Jesus is still ministering in the first compartment of the heavenly sanctuary. Thus, John turns to see one standing amongst the seven golden lampstands. Very clear. All right, verse 13. And in the midst of the seven lampstands, one like unto the Son of Man. Who's that? Jesus. Clothed with a garment down to his feet, girt about the chest with a golden band. There it is again. That is the dress of the high priest. His head and his hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as flames of fire, and his feet were like fine brass, as if refined in a furnace, and his voice sounded like many waters. Now, notice the parallel here to what Daniel sees in Daniel 10. Daniel 10, verse 6. His body, he's talking about this one clothed with white linen, his body was like beryl, his face had the appearance of lightning, his eyes were like torches of fire, his arms and his feet were like burnished bronze in color, and the sound of his words were like the voice of a multitude. Notice the parallels? This is the same being that has been described both in the book of Daniel and in Revelation chapter 1. It's a reference to Jesus. The difference is that Daniel describes Jesus before his incarnation. Here we find Jesus described in Revelation chapter 1 after his incarnation, his resurrection, and his ascension, but it is the same being that's being described. All right, what about the symbols here? The symbol of having eyes as torches of fire represent intensity of gaze and power. The penetrating gaze of Jesus discerns the thoughts and the motives of the heart. 2 Chronicles chapter 16, 9 says, "For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth." For what reason? To show himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is loyal to him. Well, that's good news. God is looking. He's looking throughout the earth to reveal his strength on behalf of those whose hearts are loyal to him. Psalms 34, verse 15, "The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry." What about the symbol of burnished brass? What does that represent? That means purity through trial. Isaiah chapter 48, verse 10 says, "Behold, I have refined you, but not as silver. I have tested you in the furnace of affliction." How is that bronze purified? Through the furnace of affliction. Is Jesus the only one that had to be purified through affliction? Or are we as followers of Christ also to be purified through affliction? Not a pleasant thought, but it's a true thought, right? Jesus endured trials and difficulties, and he says, "I can be with you. I can give you the strength. You can overcome." There is a purpose in our trials and afflictions. It purifies our faith. It refines our faith. It takes our confidence away from the things of this world, away from our money, away from our modern medicines, and puts our attention on Jesus. We've reached the end of your rope. The doctors have done everything they can do. All you have left is Jesus. Amen? When your finances aren't working out and you can't pay the bills, all you have left is Jesus. When relationships fall apart or somebody is spreading false rumors about you, all you have is Jesus. That's that refining fire. If our hearts are right with him, we can trust in him. He'll bring us through that furnace. Okay, the voice of a multitude. In Jewish writings, this represents volume, majesty, and power. It's the voice with which Jesus speaks, "Lazarus, come forth." Lazarus rose from the dead, or God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedar. Yes, the Lord splinters the cedars of Lebanon. So there is power in the voice of Jesus. Verse 7. "And I, Daniel, alone saw the vision, for the men who were with me did not see the vision, but great terror fell upon them, so that they fled to hide themselves." So Daniel has been praying. He's by the river Tigris, and there are others with him, and suddenly right there in front of him, he sees this majestic being clothed with white linen. He sees Jesus in vision. And those who are with him, they sense something different. They can't see the vision, but they sense the presence, the divine presence, and they run and fear. This is not the first time we have a record of something like this happening. Daniel alone saw the vision. However, those who were with him, they felt the presence of a divine being. They fled in fear. Their experience was similar to that of Saul's companions on the road to Damascus. The wicked will have the same experience at the second coming of Christ. Now, we don't have time to read that passage, but as Acts chapter 22, 7 to 9, it tells you the story of when Saul met Jesus on the road to Damascus. It says those who were with him, they felt this presence, they fell to the ground, they were afraid, but only Jesus appeared to Paul. Now, what about the wicked at the second coming of Christ? Revelation chapter 6, verse 14, what's going to be their experience? It says, "Then the sky receded as a scroll when it is rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place." This is the second coming of Christ. And the kings of the earth and the great men and the rich men and the commanders and the mighty men and every slave and free man hid themselves in the caves and in the rocks of the mountains. And they said to the mountains and the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits upon the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of his wrath has come. And what's the question? Who shall be able to stand? Who's going to be able to stand when Jesus comes? Well, Revelation chapter 7 tells us, the very next chapter, Revelation chapter 7 tells us who's able to stand when Jesus comes. It's those who have the seal of God in their foreheads, those who have the name of God, those who have sought for the forgiveness of their sins, those who have humbled their hearts before Jesus, those who know Jesus, those who love Jesus. They are the ones who are able to stand when Jesus comes the second time. There are two groups when Christ comes, and they're both going to say something. The wicked are going to say, oh, the great day of his wrath has come. Who's going to be able to stand? They're going to say, rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits upon the throne, from the wrath of the Lamb. But there's going to be another group, a smaller group. Are they going to look up when Jesus comes? They're going to say, this is our God. We have waited for him, and he will save us. What group do you want to be in? I want to be in that last group. Amen? And by God's grace, every single one of us can be there. When that day comes, if we're still alive, we can be there to say, this is our God. We have waited, and he will save us. That is good news. We'll be out of time for our study this morning. We'll continue next week in Daniel chapter 10, but let's close with prayer. Dear Father, once again, we are so grateful for your word and thankful for the opportunity to be able to study these very important truths. But more than anything else, Lord, we see Jesus hearing the prayer of the humble servant Daniel many years ago and coming to answer his prayer. Father, we know that in the last days, we're going to need to have that same humble heart, that same earnest desire to be right with you as Daniel was, Lord, that we might be filled with your Spirit and be able to look up and say, this is our God, we have waited for him. He will save us. Keep us faithful, for we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless. Again, we want to thank you for joining us here at the church. We're going to take a short break, and then we'll continue with our worship service.